Hello and welcome to Isurus Vlog number 13. In this vlog we're going to talk about thrash metal and we're going to talk about Pantera's Vulgar Display of Power album. So basically, if you're into thrash metal, then this vlog is for you. So I just wanted to say at the beginning, if you're not subscribed, then please subscribe to our channel, like our videos and watch our videos, share our videos. Obviously we're an independent band, we're trying to, you know, do as much as we can on our own and provide the internet and the world with hopefully some vaguely entertaining or maybe educational or who knows, otherwise interesting, yeah, laughable or humorous, yeah, humorous content for you.
I'm laughing at us, not...
Yes, no. not with us. So, today, yeah, we're going to basically give... our opinions on thrash metal, but we're going to cover the history of it, where it kind of came from, where it then led to, what it as a genre actually influenced, and so let's kick it off. Yeah. Just at the start, we're drinking beer today, in the spirit of thrash metal. I guess technically we should be drinking like Johnny Walker. Because we're talking about Pantera's Vulgar Display of Power. But anyway, I'm sure they drank beer as well.
Yeah.
So that's what we're doing. Okay, thrash metal.
Yeah. Well, thrash metal obviously is a subgenre of metal, and it's kind of the things that differentiate it from other kinds of metal are its kind of pace, its speed, its aggression. It's kind of like the start of speed metal in a way. They sort of took a lot from punk, from hardcore punk music, but with the kind of musicality and technicality that more and more developed kind of structures and stuff and patterns and riffs and drum beats of metal or rock in general. So it kind of took the spirit and the energy of punk and combined it with musicality, which punk generally didn't have.
Some punk did.
You're defending punk now.
No, I am. I've thought a bit about this. And
normally,
you know,
we were arguing and I have to defend punk to him, so that's quite a shock.
No, but you're totally right. It took the attitude, right? Mm. It took the kind of like...
And the speed as well, in a way.
Yeah, right.
The kind of fast, frenetic...
Aggressive.
Power, yeah. But yeah, with all the kind of heaviness of stuff like Sabbath and... Mm. Led Zeppelin and all that kind of stuff that came before it, and then the new wave of British heavy metal, which was the, especially for Metallica and Dave Mustaine, who was originally in Metallica and then started Megadeth, but I think it was Lars actually that got Hetfield into all this new wave of British heavy metal stuff. So
just to say what that is briefly, you got bands like Iron Maiden, Def Leppard, Black Sabbath, Motorhead are actually really influential in terms of
they're the beginnings more punk of thrash. Yeah, than a lot.
But you can really see them sort of crossing the boundary, and
well, this is probably why Metallica have covered a lot of lot of Motorhead songs.
Yeah, so it basically started in the very early 80s with there's basically like the four big thrash metal bands, right? What they called the Big Four.
The
it
big
was that
four,
tour
yeah.
they did.
Well, they've been called the Big Four for years, but they never actually managed to get them on a bill, primarily due to the issues between Metallica and Megadeth.
Yeah, and Lars actually tried to make that happen recently. Yeah. But so they are Slayer, Metallica,
Megadeth,
and Anthrax. Yeah, that's right. it really kind of like started in the start of the 80s. It was with early albums.
Yeah, like this, Kill 'Em All.
Yeah.
By Metallica, which was their first album.
Which is, this is probably one of the first out-and-out thrash albums. Something you could say is thrash. There are others, and you could sort of say some of the heavy metal, the sort of British new wave heavy metal, was really getting close to being able to be called thrash. But it was that early 80s where it really took off.
Yeah, and it became a scene, a movement with a few different bands, like we said, like the Big Four, and obviously there were loads of others as well, all playing in a similar kind of style.
Yep.
Well, one thing that's quite interesting, actually, is Dave Mustaine was obviously with Metallica when they wrote this, but he didn't actually record the album. They fired him and Kirk joined, and he actually recorded the album. But Mustaine actually wrote some of this, and even stuff they used in later albums. Like, I think he wrote some of the some bits or things that were used on Ride the Lightning and possibly even Master of Puppets, actually.
Wow.
Like riffs and just ideas and stuff. And
so yeah, that was 83, that album, wasn't it?
But what I wanted to say about Mustaine is he's... A lot of people kind of hate him for stupid reasons, basically, just because of the Metallica connection. But he actually, I think, is very formative in the whole thrash movement because he influenced Metallica's style. He obviously then formed his own band, Megadeth, but before that as well, he worked with Slayer. He played in Slayer for a while, and he influenced Kerry King a lot. And he also worked with Scott Ian at one point from Anthrax. So he's actually had his fingers in all these different bands at times.
All the different thrash pies.
Yeah, and I think he's very responsible for a lot of it.
Yeah, I agree. And amazing musician. Isn't it amazing that you have two such incredible guitar players in the same sort of area, the same sort of time, Kirk Hammett and Dave Mustaine? But then you got a lot of others, okay? Right. So, but I just mean in that Kirk Hammett joined the band, and what, you know, an incredible guitar player. So it's difficult, really, to say whether it was the right move or not for them. I guess it was, because look at them now. But I mean,
who knows?
Yeah, I mean, Dave Mustaine's definitely a genius. Yeah, so's Kirk Hammett. So basically, early 80s is where it started, and it really kind of came out of the heavy metal, sort of new wave British heavy metal bands. And there were some as well, obviously, going on at the same time in America, like Guns N' Roses, and around that time, slightly later.
Guns N' Roses were never really thrash, though, were they?
No, they weren't.
Much more rock, hot, very hard heavy rock. Rock and roll, basically.
Yeah. But that's kind of when it all sort of sprung up, and yeah, it was like an evolution in a way of punk, but, you know, people started to use or sort of lean more toward a heavy metal sound. And that was basically, it involved, you know, really shredding, the technique of shredding on the guitar.
Yeah, just heavy guitar. Fast guitar playing in terms of riffing and also soloing. Very complex stuff, basically.
Slayer are a great example of that.
Yeah. Lots and lots and lots of gain, distortion, more than had kind of been used previously for anything.
So, well, let's go into the style of it a little bit later on, but now let's talk about some of the albums that came in the 1980s that happened, because there's, for me...
This is a big one.
Yeah, for me, though, you got quite a big kind of difference between the 80s and 90s material that can be termed as thrash, in my opinion.
Yeah.
And in 80s, you got the, you know, kind of starting off with obviously, as we said, Kill 'Em All in 83 by Metallica. And then Slayer, Show No Mercy, was also released in 1983. Have we got a copy of that here?
No.
Oh, we have got it, though, I assume.
I just picked a selection of good thrash albums, basically.
And then, you know, Hell Awaits, another Slayer one, and Ride the Lightning, which is a brilliant album by Metallica, which was 84. So this is all really throughout the 80s this was happening. And it was just gaining in popularity, and they were doing these huge tours.
This was one of the biggest ones. This is a bit later on. Was this 86? Yeah, 86. Master of Puppets by Metallica, which I still think is one of their best albums.
And that goes hand in hand with this, which was also 86, Rain in Blood by Slayer.
Just flip that round. Look at those tiny little beers. I've never seen Stellas in such small cans. What is wrong with them?
There you go. Right. Yeah, they are really small. I don't know what the hell they're playing at there. Obviously, they said for their rider, you get a rider when you play a gig, they said, we'll have 12 Stellas or like 20 Stellas, and they gave them those to save some money. But yeah, it's when it really took off throughout the 80s, and it was going on throughout that time. And then it kind of moved into the early 90s with albums like this album, which is brilliant, Sepultura, Arise, which is just awesome. It's not their first album, they did some earlier albums, but in my opinion,
Schizophrenia and
in my opinion.
Oh, what was that? Beneath the Remains. Well, the Beneath the Remains.
That's right.
Their first album, then Schizophrenia, then that.
And yeah, but for me, this is where they really came into their own.
Oh yeah, that and Chaos AD, the album after that, awesome.
I kind of feel like, for me, and this is a bit controversial, but for you know, this is just my opinion. And the thrash metal that I really like is more kind of groove orientated thrash that kind of came about in the 90s.
Yeah.
You know, like Vulgar Display of Power.
Later, Sepultura.
Yep.
Machine Head. They were like.
Yeah.
I think Machine Head's first album was 94, I think.
What was their first album? Which is right here. Yeah,
I think it's 94, check.
Let's see if you're right. 1994, you are correct, well done. So yeah, Burn Myers, and this album is just epic.
Blinding.
Yeah, it's so good.
It's weird, because a lot of people that didn't really know about this album, who then heard of Machine Head a bit later on, kind of dismissed them in a way, so I don't know, they never really reproduced this, basically.
And yeah, but that album has a passion to it, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah,
it's like everything just so came together. Did so the drummer good. do any other albums with them, for them? I mean, it's just incredible.
Did he do The More Things Change? I think he did.
Yeah, he might have done. Anyway, it doesn't matter. So yeah, I mean, in my opinion, 90s is when thrash really kind of came together,
got it
together.
It got more interesting, it kind of evolved, and it was less, because as much as I love Slayer, it's kind of monotonous and it's not very innovative. You know, they don't really stray very far from their sort of formula and the way it sounds. It's all very similar.
Yeah, it doesn't vary all that much, does it?
No, not at all.
But
and I mean, obviously Metallica develops in a kind of slightly different direction. The way they kind of got more rocky, really more bluesy.
Yeah, because you got the Black album, which was released in 1991.
Mm.
So you can see, you know, for me, that's one of Metallica's best albums, if not their best album. In fact, I think it is their best album.
But that. it lost some of the elements of, like, what you'd really call genuine thrash, in a way.
Mm, yeah.
And kind of thrown away the sort of
speed. Oh, yeah, Metallica did. But I think that Pantera just maintained it. They came out with Cowboys from Hell, which was 1990. And then it was followed by Vulgar Display of Power, which we'll talk about in detail later on, 92. And then they just carried on, basically.
Yeah, Far Beyond Driven.
94.
Awesome album. And then
Great Southern Trendkill.
96. And Reinventing the Steel's the last album.
And Chaos AD, that was 93.
Mm.
So you see, start of the 90s. And I think that actually as well, and this is worthwhile saying, Slayer came out with Divine Intervention in 94, and for me, still their best album.
It's my favourite album, to be honest. I mean, I mean, as a complete album, I mean, like, there's brilliant songs on other albums, but as I was kind of saying before, I find they are a bit samey and repetitive, you know. But as an entire album, this is awesome. And also, another one which is later than this, Diabolus in Musica, is a very good album.
And that's probably their most varied album, I think. But you know what, this album I'm showing right now is Divine Intervention by Slayer, 94. And Dave Lombardo was their previous drummer, and he had done, I think, all of their albums prior to this one. And he left the band shortly before this album was released, and Paul Bostaph joined the band. And the first phrase on the album, the first bit of drumming on the album is just, it's like he was saying, okay, you know, he's setting the bar, basically, with that bit of drumming. It's just fantastic. And Paul Bostaph is an incredible drummer. And in my opinion, I think that Slayer, actually Reign in Blood and Slayer in general, I think they're kind of very much responsible for the creation of death metal. And that, you know, Reign in Blood
bands
has been,
like Morbid Angel and stuff that kind of came after them are obviously quite influenced.
But, you know, basically, Reign in Blood is kind of credited. Reign in Blood, which was in 1980s. When was that? Late 80s, 86?
86, I think.
That was kind of credited with creating or starting off the entire death metal genre. And you can really see it. And actually, the guy, Dave Lombardo, was one of the first drummers to do double kick drum playing I mean, he really kind of started that movement off. And I had, I was lucky enough to be in a drum clinic with him quite recently. It was like, well, I say recently.
It's about 10 years ago.
Yeah, it was 10 years ago. But, you know, when you're talking about the 90s and 80s, that's quite recent. So the guy's a genius. And, I think he went back with them, didn't he? Or something.
He did for a bit, yeah. Yeah.
So that was kind of...
And, well, we haven't really talked much about Megadeth as well, because they did some really good albums early on. This is actually kind of later, this is more in the 90s, I think. Yeah, this is 94, Euthanasia.
But 94.
They are their earlier albums, like Peace Cells. Very cool. This is one of my favourite Megadeth albums, that's why I brought this. This and Countdown to Extinction.
Yeah, Countdown to Extinction, I love that. What was that in 90s, Countdown to Extinction?
Yeah, I think... Yeah.
So they were doing some great albums that time as well.
Yep.
And then, where did it head? I mean, we've got one album here where...
Well, this is... I picked this out because this band, when I first got to know about them, they were the... They really reminded me of Pantera, basically.
Yeah.
Which is Lamb of God.
Yeah.
And they're from a very similar part of the world, the South in America. But they have the same kind of groove and... power and energy and stuff, and like when I first got into them, they totally knocked me out. I hadn't heard a really good metal band, the kind of thrash speed metal kind of thing, for ages, basically. And
I'm really not very good at doing this. Anyway, Sacrament by Lamb of God. For me, they're such a thrash metal band. People call them other things, but I think they're such an obviously thrash metal band, and you can just see that they're continuing the groove kind of thrash metal that. So popular,
well,
and so successful.
In the Pantera ilk.
Absolutely, absolutely. And actually, Randy Blythe is really, really good growler.
And screamer.
Well, it's a good point, actually. A good segue to move into style of thrash metal, you know, and what it is stylistically. we already spoke about
as we said,
shredding.
Yeah, it's like the fast guitar playing, fast, complex drums and kick drum patterns and stuff, so generally very intricate parts essentially on all instruments. And then vocally, which I think what you were kind of aiming at, is kind of, I don't know if growling so much, because growling really came into sort of death metal and black metal, but the kind of gruff thing. Sepultura definitely, obviously, he sings very much in a growly kind of manner.
Yeah, but I think you can basically say that thrash metal was where growling started.
Yeah.
That was certainly a kind of a big characteristic of thrash metal. Not to say that all thrash metal singers do growl all the time in the way that death metal singers do, but you know, it certainly is an element, and it's quite aggressive kind of
kind of shouting and roughness, which then got kind of exaggerated with death metal.
Yeah.
And then, of course, death metal, another thing that really defines it is the kind of lyrical subject matter, which is generally as dark and evil as possible.
But,
thrash, not so much. It's not really lyrically... There aren't any kind of real lyrical themes that make anything for thrash. It's more about the kind of... The sound.
Yeah. And so, spoke about double kick drumming. The drumming is generally pretty fast. A lot of double kick, but you know, Pantera don't really play that fast. Sometimes they do,
but it's not really
groove. There's a lot of space in it, and that's the kind of thrash I really like. I think that's actually heavier. You know, and Metallica do that a lot, especially in their later stuff. Just shows that heaviness is not speed. It's a totally different thing. But yeah, double kick playing on the drums, and you know, just generally being pretty busy on the kit. Vinnie Paul's a brilliant drummer. We'll talk about him a bit later. I think that's it, really. And, you know, shredding on the guitar. Aggressive sound. So, let's go on to talk about how it influenced us.
Well, massively, really.
Yes.
when I first started playing the guitar, I was... I don't know, from when I was really young, like... I don't know, like 9, 10 years old, I was sort of into stuff like Guns N' Roses, and then later got into kind of like Metallica, and by the time I was sort of 12, 13, I was just listening to all sorts of thrash music, basically, like Slayer, Metallica, Megadeth, Sepultura a lot, and Pantera. And Pantera, for us two combined, they were something that we used to listen to a hell of a lot.
Yeah, they...
And it was really weird recently, because I don't really listen to it too much these days, but I had listened to this album, like, within the last year, and I listened to it this week, and I kind of realised that I've kind of completely assimilated all those kind of riffs and that kind of energy, and it's actually such a, it's like in my blood almost, it's like a part of the way I kind of express myself for playing. I kind of see a lot of similarities to, like, in the riffing kind of thing to especially Pantera and Metallica.
Yeah.
It's a big influence.
In a way, I mean, I remember when we formed the band, and although it wasn't called Isurus at the time, in the year, it's like 99 or 2000 or something like that, 15 years ago, sorry, I don't know what year it is. So 15 years ago, this was such an important album for us. We used to listen to this a hell of a lot, and a lot of Metallica as well.
Well, that and Far Beyond Driven. And this as well, was, I bought this the year it came out, when I was actually on a school trip to a Shakespeare school trip, and I legged it from the party that was going on, wandering around Stratford-upon-Avon. And I ran into a music shop to go and get this, because it had just come out, like, literally that week.
So a lot of the albums we've been talking about, really, I mean, like, a lot of this stuff was... We were really, really big fans of thrash at the time in the 90s. And in a way, at the start, we were kind of a thrash metal band. We've said it before.
Yeah, we were. But, I mean, we were never straight up thrash. I mean, we always had a lot of other kind of elements in there. We always had a lot of the kind of lighter, more progressive stuff. Because, I mean, we've both been fans of sort of progressive rock and stuff as long as this kind of thing. You know, like Pink Floyd and... Jimi Hendrix, I've been listening to since I was a little kid, and that's
Radiohead.
Yeah,
there's loads of things we could talk about, but specifically thrash.
In terms
is kind
of the stuff when we play heavy, thrash is the influence.
And we definitely maintain that, don't we?
Oh yeah.
And that's kind of, I think, what differentiates us from a lot of the kind of bands that you would term in a way. I'll give you a few examples of bands. A Carnival.
Even Tool, like, people often compare us to Tool and Carnival and stuff, but we're a lot heavier than both of them.
Yeah.
And we have those kind of thrash elements.
That's the difference. Yeah.
And, I mean,
thrash
almost,
is the difference.
Like, on Logacharia, our latest album, like, there's a couple of things on there that are, like, you know, verging on death metal, really. Little elements.
I suppose.
Like riffs and parts, I mean, you know, not like entire songs.
Yeah.
But it's like that kind of, that range, we've always kept that level of, we can always kind of call on that level of aggression and speed when we want to, I think, which is...
Yeah, but, you know, we've basically just, you're right, we've assimilated it.
Yeah.
It's just there now.
Because I was listening to this and I just knew it note for note.
Absolutely.
And without, you know...
Pretty much every thrash album, you know, is just completely ingrained in my mind, you know, subconsciously even. So.
And I'm so pleased to have seen Pantera, Sepultura, Machine Head, Metallica, Slayer live in their heyday. I'm so fucking happy about that. Because
Pantera are amazing live.
They either don't exist, or the lineups have changed, or they've changed so much since then. You know, it's like. It's not really the same thing if you see them live nowadays.
Oh, you're right.
The ones that you can still see live.
Yeah.
Apart from maybe Slayer, actually. They haven't really changed at all.
No, you're right. No, exactly. They haven't. They've even got Dave Lombardo, I think. So they've just carried on doing the same thing. They really haven't changed, have they, much at all. It's
weird. If it ain't broke.
Fox Sprickets.
Yeah. Exactly. Right, shall we... stop talking shit and talk about Pantera.
We'll have a little break here, I think, and then come back and talk more shit.
Right, we're back, and we're going to talk about Pantera's Vulgar Display of Power. 1992. Severely good album, their second album.
Severely good,
severely
like
good album, yeah, it is. this was where they really found their sound, because Cowboys from Hell, before it, was more... Well, I'll start with, they kind of started out as more of a kind of glam metal band, which is kind of strange, because I kind of hate all that kind of music, like Kiss, and I've never liked it at all.
Me neither.
And they kind of started out like that, like the Abbott brothers, the guitarist and drummer, Vinnie Poole and Dimebag. They're both huge, huge Kiss fans, like ridiculous.
Really?
Yeah. They've
I
got,
didn't know that.
Especially Vinnie Poole's got like a massive Kiss collection, like pinball tape.
Oh, you can buy so much Kiss stuff.
Yeah, it's a joke. But anyway, I don't really want to talk about Kiss. but Cowboys from Hell was much more... It didn't really sound like glam metal, but it was a bit more... I don't know how to put it.
Glam rock?
A bit more happy. I don't know if that makes sense. Like...
It was less aggressive, it was less kind of gritty, it was more fluffy, but that not saying that it was a fluffy album, it's a brilliant album.
It is a very good album,
but the guitars definitely aren't as kind of heavy sounding, and their general sound is just not as wasn't as heavy before that, and it's a really interesting point you said about them being into glam, because they were a glam.
I've seen some photos of them when they were like dressed up when they were like really young and doing their early gigs and stuff, and it's hilarious.
Sad.
Yeah.
They were called Pantera's Metal Magic.
Do you know where Pantera came from?
No.
It's when they were the two brothers, when they were kids, they used to have this kind of game. Which one of them would chase the other one around with a frying pan and try and beat them up with it. And that
Pantera.
Was Pantera. That was the name of the game.
Right.
And it turned into Pantera.
Interesting.
but yeah. So I think what that was all getting up to was, I think this is where they really found their own unique kind of sound. Because from this album, it was kind of more along that kind of vein. They kind of really found their own sort of style, and
I would call Cowboys from Hell thrash.
Yeah.
But this is where they really nailed the sound, the groove. You're right. They fell into the groove.
It's almost like it's more bluesy in a way. It's got that kind of dirty, gritty, slower kind of elements to it, and still with a lot of fast playing, fast techniques, but having a kind of a slower sort of pulse and having a lot more space in it, so it's not just having a lot of broken up things, lots more gaps in the riffs and parts. And
And I think that maybe it took a while for Phil Anselmo, the vocalist, which you probably 99% already know if you're watching this video, but and got to this point, but it took a while for him, Phil Anselmo, to get sort of integrated into the band, and also I think that this is when they really gelled as a band, and you can see that really well on the videos that they did. They did three videos. It was called Three Vulgar Videos, something like that, and those videos were so influential on me. It wasn't just their music, of course it was pretty much all their music, but those videos of them, and the way that they were kind of just completely out of control on tour. So entertaining. Those videos are brilliant. Mm-hmm. Get them. If you're a Pantera fan, you haven't watched those videos, holy crap, you've got to. They're really good.
Yeah, they did a lot of fucking around.
Yeah, they did, yeah. And, so actually, I think Cowboys from Hell is when they signed with a bigger label. And this is the second album that they released
on
that label. And
Division of Atlantic.
Yeah, for me, I remember that this was actually the first thrash metal album I really got into.
I don't know. Like Arise was probably before that.
No, you're totally right. Yes, no. Even though you're talking about me, you're actually more correct than I am on that. Arise, I remember I got that, I think, short. No. It wasn't Arise. It was Chaos AD that I got when it came out, which was, I don't know how old I was, but I was very young.
I don't know when that was, like maybe 90...
Chaos AD? 93. Yeah. And I got it because everyone else thought, in the school I was in, was thinking that it was really cool. So I wanted to be cool as well, like the older kids. And so I got it. But anyway, this album for me, really, really important.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
This really confirmed.
The thing about them that they have is it's just these. It's like we said this before about heaviness. It's not about being fast and just ridiculously thrashy. It's about having the groove and the pulse and the rhythm and the thing that really gets your head going, you know.
Yeah,
and
space is just as important.
Yeah, yeah. And that's what they do so well. And as well with like Metallica later on, you know, it's because that's something absolutely. I always find with like death metal. I don't find it
heavy.
Particularly heavy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just
when it's all
there's
one
no level, dynamic.
There's no tension and release.
Yeah,
it's all
exactly.
tension,
it's
tension,
all tension. Yeah, exactly.
And you need the release to really kind of dig into the heaviness.
Because something that we've always done, and I think that came from them, is the kind of whole halftime thing. And as well from
Machine. We used to do that a lot.
Yeah, we used to do that a lot. But still do, I think. I can't really think of any particular.
I don't know. I
can't actually remember any of our music, so.
No, me neither.
But yeah.
Living in the moment.
Mm.
So, yeah, I mean, but I think that groove characteristic of the music, of that album, was so influential for me. It's brilliant. And I think that this was the first album, actually. Wait a second. When was the Black album released?
91.
All right, okay. So this was the second album. that, in my opinion, really nailed that groove kind of element of it. And I wonder how much they were influenced by that. Probably quite a lot.
Yeah, well, they've obviously always been big fans of Metallica. But, yeah, don't know.
But their style is different. Their sound is different.
I don't know. I think they would have been working on this kind of stuff, you know, at a similar sort of time, really.
Mm.
And yeah, I mean, Pantera are kind of heavier than Metallica, really.
Yeah.
Well, it's more of a. I don't know. It's just kind of a
more aggressive,
darker, aggressive energy.
More aggressive.
Yeah.
And so the album was produced by a guy called Terry Waite, and when I say the album, I mean Vulgar Display of Power by Pantera. I've been speaking about a lot of albums, but so I mean that album, Terry Date. He's also worked with Slayer, Dream Theater, Slipknot, Deftones, and Limp Bizkit. Dave, why on our notes for this video did you call Limp? What was it? Limp Dick Shit.
Yeah, and Shitknot. I don't know why that happened.
That's weird. So yeah, a very influential producer who helped them, and it was actually mixed by Terry Date. And something that was really interesting for me when I was looking into like researching this album was that Vinnie Paul, drummer, is also credited with production, engineering, and mixing.
Mm.
So he must have been working with Terry Date a lot on the sound of the album. Which is a nice segue into talking about the sound of the album. It is so tapey.
Yeah. It's weird in a way, because, yeah, it's very tapey, but it's also very digitally in a weird way, because there's digital reverbs, especially on the drum kit. There's much more reverb than people normally use in kind of metal.
Well, nowadays, at least, yeah. No, you're right.
And the guitar.
That's the glam for you.
Yeah, I suppose it's still seeping in. The guitar is very strange because his guitar sound is actually, in my opinion anyway, pretty bad. Because he didn't use valve amps, he used Randalls, which are solid state, and he loved them. And I don't know why, really. Because they're really thin and buzzy. It's like almost the exact thing I try and dial out of my guitar sound.
I like it. I like it.
Do you?
I don't. The reason I like it, right, is because in a mix, I find that having that high end in the guitar really makes it cut. It really makes it so audible. And
I know that, but it's not just about having that. It also lacks so much. It lacks a lot of the weight and the kind of sag you get from vowels. It kind of just doesn't have the depth to it. It's very, it's like it's on a very thin plane.
Mm.
It's when you listen with a valve distortion, it's really dense and thick, and you've got these odd harmonics going on.
Oh, right, of course. Yeah. Yeah, you've got to have valves.
Yeah.
Really. I mean, you know, come on. You're talking about guitar here. You gotta have valves, Kemper. Anyway, we could get sidetracked on that. What I hear in the sound of the album is it's actually quite well balanced in the EQ, but it feels like it's got a really massive like high end and low end kind of smile curve EQ wise. And up and there's quite a lot of detail and high end, especially in the drums.
Another important thing as well, actually, which I think something that kind of defined their sound is that they had the bass kind of much more audible than a lot of thrash metal.
Which is that smile.
Yeah. Curve. No, I mean the bass guitar itself.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, compared to sort of Metallica and Megadeth and stuff, the bass is a lot more, much more behind the guitars.
Yeah. Not a lot of low end in the guitar, a lot of space for the bass, and it generally sounds pretty nicely balanced. I hear so much tape in it, you know, the compression in the high end, like the kick and the snare. It's just so, like, when I hear the album, I just think, tape, you know, I can't help it. So obviously it was recorded to tape. Mastered by a guy called Howie Weinberg. I should know how to pronounce his name without having to think about it. He's a very, very well-established and prolific mastering engineer. He has worked with countless bands, and he is very good at what he does. I think he's a really good mastering engineer. So, the dynamic range of the album, what I want to do is I want you to guess what you think the dynamic range of the album is. Bearing in mind the time frame, bearing in mind this was 92, bearing in mind...
It's got a fair amount of dynamics in it, I'd say. I reckon it's probably about 9 or 10.
Bingo!
Really?
Yep. It sort of ranges from 9 to 11, but I would say it's sort of like 10 is where it's at. And yeah, you're right. And that it's not really a victim of the loudness wars, and it benefits a hell of a lot from that.
The loudness wars hadn't started yet.
It's getting started. This is where it started, really.
They were victims of the digital reverb wars, though.
yeah, but it's not the end of the world. I prefer that than massive compression.
Yeah, definitely.
What else have you got to say about the album? It is, well, a brilliant freaking album. It's just enjoyable.
It's got so many.
It's really aggressive, but at the same time, there's you know, is it This Love, which is kind of
the last track, Hollow, which was written about one of their friends that died.
Yeah. So there's a lot of variation in terms of the actual kind of intent and you know, it's not all out aggressive all the time. There's a lot of variation.
The first five tracks is just kick-ass. It's Mouthful, War, A New Level, Walk, Fucking Hostile, and This Love. They're all such good songs.
We have to talk about Walk.
Yeah, Walk is... Yeah, that's one of the...
best songs in the world.
Yeah, in terms of the whole kind of simple riff. And it is just a drop D single string riff.
In 12-8.
For the most part, yeah.
It's in 12-8.
So, really sparse, really simple. Kind of almost like the sort of stuff that later on Tom Morello kind of did, the kind of single string, simple, spacey, not in terms of like echo and delay, but spacey in terms of, you know, long held notes and gaps and
so
and
simple.
Just so catchy and just on the pulse, just on it. Like
I can play it.
Well, probably partially.
I can play. Well, I can play that. That you know, the start of the song, basically. Yeah, I can play that. And I have played it many times in the past, and enjoyed it on acoustic guitar though.
I write a lot of metal on acoustic guitars. Nothing wrong with that.
I can play that and "Come As You Are" by Nirvana. They're the two things I can play on guitar. So I clearly need to get some lessons from Drew James. Okay. What else? Yeah, for me that was like Walk was just such a. Again, I have said it a million times, but influential.
Yeah.
Influential song for me. It's the bluesiness of it. It's the grooviness, but the heaviness, the simplicity, everything kind of just came together. Awesome.
It's all good. There's not a bad track on here. It's so good.
And also, just speaking about Pantera in general, there is, what's that live CD?
101% Proof.
There's one amazing bit of guitar on.
Yeah,
on
that's in Walk, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
He does like a variation. He does this like little quad.
Brilliant.
It's good.
It just shows, you know, how good he is. Obviously, Dimebag Darrell was very, who's the guitarist, very sadly, he was shot.
Yeah, by one of his fans. Basically a nutter.
Yeah, which is a massive loss.
Yeah, we were both in music college.
What an
asshole,
what a dickhead who did that.
I was at guitar college when that happened. And it was really weird because there were a lot of guitarists that were obviously into that kind of music. So everyone was talking about it, and then there were also guitarists that were much more kind of blues guitarists and didn't even know who he was. And I remember one of our tutors, one of our rock techniques teachers, like basically a shred teacher, was not impressed by these people that didn't know who Dimebag Darrell was. So we spent.
He should have refused.
We spent about 2 hours just listening to Pantera.
Good teacher.
And playing Pantera riffs and stuff.
That's the kind of college you want to be in.
Yeah, that's good.
That's time well spent, yeah. But I mean, to be frank.
A guy called Charlie Griffiths, actually, if you look him up, he was, and I don't know if he still does, play with a band called Linear Sphere, with another guy I was taught by as well, whose name completely escapes me right now, which is really bad. oh my god. That's terrible.
In the interim. Yeah, yeah, it was incredibly sad thing. And I remember when it happened,
really
I was
just such a waste.
I just felt like, get that guy who did that and shoot him in the head.
Well, he did get shot by the police.
Did he?
Yeah.
Is he dead?
I think so. I think he got shot by the police. I'm not 100% on that, but I think the police...
Obviously, the police were Pantera fans.
...were involved, and I'm pretty sure he was shot by the police. Or he shot himself. I can't remember.
Anyway, what a twat. Very sad, but at the same time, I have to say, kind of typical for Dimebag Darrell to live the life that he lived in the way he lived it. Go watch... It's actually 3 Vulgar videos from hell.
Yeah, that's it.
Go check them out. And it just shows what, you know, what he's all about.
Yeah. They were, at the time, obviously, they were VHS. There were 3 VHS videos. But now you can get it on DVD, and all of them are on one DVD.
Gotta get it. Anyone who's a Thrash fan, supposed Thrash fan, who doesn't have those videos, just, you're not a Thrash fan until you've watched that. Anyway, so, but you see what I mean? It's kind of like, if he's going to die, that's the way
he's
going to die.
Yeah, he's such an extrovert, like, everything he did was just so out there and outlandish and just over the top. Mm. So, yeah, it's kind of, sounds horrible to say, but in a way, it's kind of a fitting way for someone like him to die, really, in a completely bizarre.
You're right, but really horrible, because what you always get from him, like, what the energy I've always got from him is that he's actually really positive energetic
and was really happy
passionate and just a fun kind of person, you know, and so that's a kind of morbid and horrible way to end our review of Vulgar Display of Power. Yeah. Brilliant album. Now we're going to rate it out of 10.
I think I'll probably give it a 10.
That's the second album you're giving a 10.
Is it?
Yeah.
What else did I give a 10 to?
You gave Blackwater Park a 10.
Oh yeah, that's a Opeth. Fucking good album, that's why.
Yeah, well, this is a fucking good album as well. I haven't gone to 10 yet. It's really hard not to for this album, but I'm gonna hold off. I gave Blackwater Park 9.25. I'm gonna give it 9.5. I'm putting it ahead of Blackwater Park just because of how massively influential it was.
It's hugely influential.
Both those albums are really top notch albums, and you know, we recommend you to get it and listen to it if you haven't. Hmm. Okay, so that's it for Vulgar Display of Power by Pantera. Brilliant album.
Did we mention that it's really good?
Yes.
We did, okay. I hope we got that across.
Yeah, we love the album. Okay, so I think that's basically it for the vlog today. Is there anything else? What's going on with the band? With our band?
Our band? I don't know. What's going on? Reviews and radio play being planned and scheduled, basically.
Our new album, Logocharia, is now available to stream on Spotify.
Mm. Is it on Tidal yet? Have you checked?
I don't know.
It will be on Tidal. I don't know if it's quite yet. All these different companies have different ingestion periods, how long it takes them to get them live on their servers and stuff.
It's obviously available for sale. So, you know, we've
been shipping them, because we've obviously got a big pile of 1,000 of these, or 999 after I burnt one. And
plus we sold.
Initially. So we've been selling them, shipping them all over the world. They've been going all over Europe, like Holland,
Australia, Germany, America, pretty much everywhere.
Yeah, all over the place, really. I don't think we've sent one to Asia yet.
Haven't we?
No. I think they've all been Europe, Australasia, and the US.
Wow, okay, fair enough. So,
Can someone in, you know, China or India buy one?
Yes, please. So I want to say thank you to everyone who's bought the album, especially who's bought the digibook version. Really appreciate it. You know, it helps us, it kind of supports us and keeps us doing what we're doing. And, you know, for anyone who's watching this video, hasn't seen any of our previous videos, please subscribe to our channel, and if you are a regular viewer and you haven't for whatever reason, or a fan of ours already, please subscribe to our channel, like our videos. It all kind of helps to keep us going in general, and you know, we're fully independent band, so we're relying on you guys to take those kind of actions. It's not very difficult to click a button, subscribe. It should be down, where would it be, like down here? Somewhere,
isn't it? Up.
Is it?
I don't know.
It's I think it's there, right? We'll see who's right. I think it's there.
Maybe.
But anyway, thank you very much for watching. And we will be back in around a week from today with another installment of the Isurus Vlog. We're going to talk a lot about different genres of metal and rock. We're going to start reviewing bands in much more full, look at all of their careers. And basically, you know, we plan on this series being something you can watch and gain information, maybe speak to some of the other people who comment, and eventually build a community who kind of into the same kind of stuff.
Discover new music, and maybe people can point people in the direction of certain bands and stuff that may be interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the idea.
Yeah.
So thanks for watching, and see you in about a week.